Hi, Carl here for Pro VTV. I'm at the Blackmagic stand at IBC 2018 talking to Craig. Okay, so Craig, we've got a new RAW format.
Tell us about it. At IBC 2018, we've announced Blackmagic RAW. It's in the Ursa Mini Pro 4.6K now, available to download through the website with the camera updater version 6. And it's a very exciting new format for us, offers something that our cameras haven't really had previously, and addresses some of the concerns that customers have about really working with RAW and the demands that RAW formats have, both in camera in terms of compression or the recording demands to media, and also then processing RAW. We've always spoke about and sort of eulogized the idea and the performance and the quality of RAW formats, and it's always been something we've put in our cinema camera product.
With Cinema DNG.
Exactly, yeah, but Cinema DNG itself has always had certain complications. It didn't provide us the full latitude we wanted. As an image sequence system, it was cumbersome really in post. And we had problems where maybe the color science that's built into Resolve to support Cinema DNG wasn't always available, so that you would look at the RAW files differently, or they'd look clipped in certain other software where they didn't natively look. So we've changed the way that we're going to be working with RAW, with Blackmagic RAW entirely. So the first thing is it's a single file, it's not an image sequence. And then we're also going to be using the camera itself to actually do some of the heavy lifting and the processing. So we do a partial demosaic in camera. So that means with the actual format, we start using the camera processing to provide some of the hardware development around RAW, rather than just being GPU and CPU intensive in Resolve. There's also some efficiencies in the codec itself, so that we have much more streamlined RAW format rather than Cinema DNG, which was very big file sizes, you know, 11 meg roughly per frame. What we have instead is a RAW format for us here with Blackmagic RAW, where we have file sizes that are equivalent to, say, ProRes 422. So at a, let's say 4.6K full sensor at 30 frames a second from this camera, a 256 gig card is going to give you about 90 minutes to 100 minutes of recording.
That's amazing. That's going to be realistically one of the biggest differences it makes. I mean, with Cinema DNG, you'd get, what, 14 minutes on a 128 gigabyte card?
Around that. Plus then all the time required to process and work through that in RAW. And it demanded a little bit of knowledge to how to work in Resolve, for example. But what we have in the camera now is a really nice, efficient end-to-end codec. So you can record in camera. You can then have a codec that's suitable for editing. It isn't having to be heavily processed frame by frame, so it's fast and efficient when Resolve edits. But underneath, it's always a non-linear 12-bit file.
So it's, okay, so it's 12-bit at heart.
It is, yeah. So that means that we've got all that color depth, all that latitude. So you then jump straight into grading and can work with it from a grading point of view as well.
So this is a compressed RAW format, presumably. Do you get varying qualities?
Yeah, so there's two platforms for the recording. There's a constant bitrate mode, so it has a fairly familiar compression scale. So we offer 3:1, 5:1, 8:1, and 12:1. And then naturally you can understand as your bitrate really changes there, your recording media time will increase. And you can make the decision. And 12:1 is still really clean and sharp for us, even up at ISO 1600 in this camera. As adjunct to that, we have a constant quality. So here we have a base limit, so we have a constant targeted bit rate, but we allow a little bit of headroom where required. So we have something called Q0 in the camera, which is really as close as uncompressed. It's visually lossless in terms of quality, but as it's recording, it's logically looking at frame to frame, and if it needs to just bump the data rate a little bit, it'll do that with the headroom we allow. If that is a little bit still big in file size, you can drop to Q5, so the quantizer that's working on that algorithm starts to be a little bit more aggressive in the way that it works on the compression, but it's still very high quality. And then that has a slightly different headroom to it as well. And you can choose in the camera which of those you want. So within the camera, you'll still have Cinema DNG RAW. You'll have the family of ProRes that we've supported.
Okay, so Cinema DNG is staying?
Yeah, in the camera now and in the package that you can download on version 6. Because we think there are people still out there that want to work in that full RAW format or maybe have established workflows. We don't want to take that away. But obviously they might want to look at Blackmagic RAW. So the Q0 or the 3:1 is ideal for high-end and VFX work. The going down through that ratio of compression scales, you're getting guys that maybe want to do fast turnaround work. And then down at sort of like the Q5 and the 8:1, 12:1, you've got something that's faster and maybe longer recording media.
So when would people choose the constant bitrate versus the quality one? What's the difference between them in terms of real-world usage?
Well, the constant bitrate allows you to mathematically know what your recording time is.
Okay, so it's predictable.
It's predictable. So you can know, and let's say if you wanted to work in the mid-range of those options, you can then assess where you're going to be. So maybe if you're run and gun or you're doing commercial or interview work, you kind of need to know where you are. But if your concern's really more about, as we did previously with Cinema DNG, retaining all of that color fidelity, the latitude off the camera, and the full capability, that's where the constant quality is the better option. And you can choose between the Q0 or Q5, and then take that through to post.
So for people not concerned about storage space at all, doesn't matter how big the files are, we just want the best quality possible. It's the constant quality one, the highest one.
It is, yeah, but you still have with Blackmagic RAW the advantages of it being a much more efficient codec. So your file sizes are going to be much greater reduced. There's some information on our website about the actual data rates within there. There isn't a set data rate for the Q0, Q5 because there is a kind of headroom that it moves into. But when you start working with it, you'll see it's not going to be the same as Cinema DNG. It's much more efficient. It's a smaller, tighter codec from a recording point of view.
How is it to work with in Resolve? Is it a bit more streamlined than Cinema DNG used to be?
So it's natively supported. Resolve 15.1 has gone up online now, so you can download and work that straight away. It's fast. It's quick. The actual codec itself is really sort of designed to work around AVX, AVX2, SSE. It's fully optimized to work around OpenCL, CUDA, Apple Metal. So it's a really faster, efficient format to work in Resolve as well. So that means you're not talking about, you know, Resolve requiring high-end GPU processing or faster media. So we've got reduced file sizes, reduced data rate requirements. So you could be editing Blackmagic RAW on attached USB drives on laptops, but still working with a 12-bit non-linear file. So it gives you all of that efficiency.
So at the moment it's only supported in Resolve, is that right?
That's right, yeah. There's an SDK that's gone up online as well. So that has a software decoder. It's got some code in there and some examples of what we can do with that SDK. And the intention here, and what we've announced at IBC, is we're talking to software partners about how they can integrate and use it.
So we could potentially see this in the future in NLEs and things like that as well?
Yeah, we think so. And we're really excited about what that offers, because obviously there's people out there that maybe Resolve isn't their software of choice. Obviously use what you want to. And we'd like to see Blackmagic RAW run throughout the whole post-production environment so it supports it.
Very cool.
There's also the Blackmagic RAW player.
Okay.
So if you don't have Resolve on your machines, we also have a sidecar RAW player system, so you can actually view the files and look at them online, on your system, and play them back as you need to there as well.
That's useful for dailies and things like that. Nice.
Yeah, and on set, or just checking and making sure visually you've got the shot you wanted to.
Cool. Now, the obvious question is, right now it's only on the S Mini Pro, is that right? Is it coming to the Pocket?
So we're going to work on Pocket, see that we can get it on Pocket Cinema Camera 4K in the near future. That camera's ready to ship.
Yeah, which we're very excited about.
Absolutely, yeah. So we're looking to see that in the hands of and customers in the coming weeks. We'll look to get Blackmagic RAW into that product. And then what we'll do is have a look at the other hardware products we have both on the camera side and see where we can put Blackmagic RAW ourselves into existing cinema products.
And I guess on recorded as well, like the video assist line and things like that.
Yeah, definitely potential for us to do that. And that opens up a whole different world for us in terms of what we can do with video assist and how that can support filmmakers and using Blackmagic RAW away from the Blackmagic cameras.
Yeah, it's all very exciting. Right, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you for your time.